Thank you very much. And we're very pleased to have today in our CEO series, Sir Martin Sorrell, who is one of the best known businessmen in the world and certainly one of the leaders over the last several decades in the advertising world. Before we get into the advertising world and some other things we want to talk about, Martin, I'm just curious, you and I travel a lot. We used to travel a lot. What's it like being penned up in, let's say, your home in London or your office in London? You're used to traveling probably three quarters of the time. Has this been a big change in you, and you like it better or you like it worse?
Well, you can see I'm in my pajamas. You're respectably dressed, David, and I'm in my pajamas. So I like it, David. It's a terrible thing to say about COVID when it's caused such havoc. But I must say, in the last year, it is a year now, I feel from a personal point of view, physical point, you know, getting into to a hotel at 11 o'clock at night and taking a call at 3:30 or 4 o'clock in the morning is not paradise, as you well know. So I feel a little bit more rested. And up to the point, I don't think I'll go back to that. It won't be a new normal. It'll be a next normal. I think I'll be less in the office. Our people certainly will be. We reckon probably 3 days in the office. We consolidated our leases in our new operation, S4 Capital. And we have, what, now 4,400 people in 31 countries in 56 cities. So it's enabled us to jettison leases and consolidate properties much faster. And we'll go into different spaces where people can congregate, where they can work, meet their colleagues, and then meet clients. Probably have different types of spaces, less office space, more variable commuting, more dispersed living, and more dispersed working. So I think it'll be a much more flexible environment. And I think as far as I'm concerned, I'll be making, to your point on travel, longer trips, fewer and longer trips. So I think I'm due to go to Singapore in August. I'll probably go to the region for 2 weeks and then come back, whereas in the old days, I might go to Singapore and come back immediately. So I must say I've been pleasantly surprised. And technology, as you know, for example, road shows with institutions. Why was it that we went from one side of America to another when we could easily do this, or much more easily do it with this type of technology?
So in London, you, I assume, have been vaccinated by now. What was it like? And is everybody feeling that they're going to get vaccinated relatively soon, or is there still a lockdown environment in London?
Well, we're still in lockdown, although we're coming out of it. I see that Angela Merkel I think things are easing a little bit in New York, or there've been some announcements today or the last day or so about that. And Angela Merkel's easing in Germany, and we will start to ease. The schools are due to go back sort of strangely for about 10 days from March the 8th before they have their pre-summer term break. And then we'll have restaurants opening, I think it's April the 12th. I think some indoor dining and some outdoor dining. So we're starting to ease. On the government didn't do a very good job on lockdown, got heavily criticised for it. We were talking in our prep session about some of the things that Tony Blair said. But they've done a good job on vaccination. There was a woman called Kate Bingham who was seconded to buy vaccines and the vaccine program, and she did an outstanding job. And I think she's stepped down after 6 months, but a super job. And Boris Johnson and the government have picked up, I think, a fair bit of traction to the cost of the Labour opposition, a fair bit of traction from the vaccination program. So I think but we certainly will have enough vaccine to distribute elsewhere. And we're probably getting up for about a third of the population have been vaccinated. So we're a little bit behind Israel, but they've done a good job on vaccination. And I think by the summer, most people will have been vaccinated. And I'm very bullish, David, I know that we'll get into this. I'm very bullish about what happens from Q2 onwards from a real world perspective, maybe not from stock markets, but real world perspective.
So you obviously are a believer in the power of advertising, given your career. So if the prime minister said a lot of people don't want to be vaccinated, they think it might be dangerous, and there's certainly a percentage of the United States that don't want to be vaccinated, you think a good advertising campaign could persuade people to be vaccinated who don't otherwise want to be vaccinated?
I certainly do. I mean, you may have seen they drafted in the Queen to try and speed vaccination. I don't think the anti-vaxxers here have been quite in the UK, have been quite as prevalent or as impactful as they have in some other countries. And I think it's gone very well. I think people have been very impressed by it. And we're starting now reaching into the 50-year-olds. I'm a grand old man of 76. I had my first vaccination, the Pfizer vaccine, and I had a terrible reaction. I shivered at night, my feet were like ice blocks, and then I got into a sweaty fever, and then the following day I had some symptoms. But I'm due to have my second shot on April the 6th with some degree of trepidation. But as Tony Blair said, why don't you postpone the second doses, and that way we'll get more people vaccinated. And as you know, I think Pfizer and AstraZeneca are meant to give about 83 or so percent protection on the first shot, first Pfizer shot anyway. So maybe that was the best way of doing it.
Now, in the advertising world, if you have an advertising campaign for some product or service, do you think if it's a bad product or service, good advertising can overcome the defect of the product or service, or in the end, does the quality of the product or service win out?
Well, we have a daily call of the top eight people in our company. We meet at 2 o'clock every day. They're in Singapore and Amsterdam. I'm in London and Boulder, Colorado, and Scottsdale, Arizona. And I asked them this question because I thought it was a bit of a stinker. So I asked them, and the view was, and we're not going to name the products or services, but we did come to the view, the general view of our eight leaders was that that good advertising can sort of maintain the momentum of a less than adequate product. The conventional wisdom is you can only sell a bad product once. It's rather like political advertising. The electorate doesn't like who you're trying to sell. You know, the second time around the ballot box, you'll get to know it. But our view was, and I'm not going to name those products or services, David, that would be too invidious a position for you to put me in. So, but basically, we do think that great emotional advertising, ones that establish a strong emotional bond and relationship, can be really effective. It helps when the product or service is outstanding. I also add that our operation S4 is purely a digital operation. WPP was probably, when I left 3 years ago, about 60% traditional and 40% digital. In the digital world, relationships, it's particularly important given what happened yesterday with Google's announcement about the demise of third-party cookies. This is data from third-party sources by which you can track people. And Google basically, along with Apple, said on the grounds of privacy to the first-party data, that is client data, data that client owns. For example, a Procter & Gamble owns about 1.2 billion consumer profiles. So this is direct consented data that they have. And I would just say that in a digital world, relationship building is critically important. And what we're going to see, we've already seen it, but what we're going to see increasingly in the digital world, the building of relationships through the use of consented data and through content developed from that data and distributed through digital media.
So are there campaigns, let's say an advertising campaign, you think was spectacularly successful, a classic great one? Or is there any one you say was a classic one that didn't really work?
I'm never going to say the ones that don't work. I think there's a great, again, I asked my colleagues for their views, and we've got all of the view that the old spy, not ads that were done at WPP or indeed S4, it was Weidman Kennedy, the old Spice ads, which is a Procter & Gamble brand, were outstanding. And then we think the Airbnb campaign, the We Like a Local, that's probably a little bit more in our sphere. Interestingly, we think the agency that came up with We Like a Local lost the business. We love the campaign, lost the business pretty quickly. There have been disasters, which one shouldn't name or name the agencies involved. But so I would pick out those campaigns. And Nike does a great job. I think Apple has done a great job. Google has done very good work. There are obviously Coca-Cola historically have done outstanding campaigns. Procter, always. I mean, there are outstanding campaigns, but we pick out the Old Spice and the Airbnb.
So if I came to you and said, I have a new product or service, I want to advertise it, but I only have a limited amount of money, would you recommend I put the advertisement in television, radio, newspapers, social media, streaming services, on a blimp somewhere? Where would I guess by?
It's all digital, David. I think personalization at scale. I mean, just the model that I've been doing S4 for what, 2.5 years, and we're purely digital and we're very focused on that part, which is about half of the media market. So the market is about 500 to 550 billion in media, about 500 billion in marketing services, and about 700 billion in trade budget. So it's about 1.7, 1.8 trillion in total. But coming back to your small break into the market, I would say digital media gives you personalization at scale. And the Netflix model is a really good example. So when we do campaigns, say for Narcos 3, let's take that as an example, we created in that case 1.6 million different potential creative executions. And then we track David Rubenstein. We see, we don't know it's you. We have a number, but we don't know it's you personally. And we watch what, on WallStreetJournal.com, or you might be on the New England Patriots site. So we'll serve you a piece of content which compares Narcos 3 to a business,
okay,
in the case of the Wall Street Journal, or a sport or team in the case of the Patriots. So I think that's where, and that for a relatively small absolute amount of money, you can measure the effectiveness much more effectively and get the sort of results that you would demand given your success record.
So what is a nice Jewish boy from London who went to Cambridge and Harvard Business School? How did you avoid private equity or investment banking or things important like that? How did you get into advertising?
Well, it's purely by accident, actually, David. I was working for an entrepreneur called James Gull. Actually, he was in the food retailing business. And Dad asked me how. He built a food retailing business that he sold to the Sarnoffs at RCA Corporation. He made a lot of money. And I was his gopher. I was I was called financial advisor, but actually I was carrying his bag. And one of the investments that he made was in a very traditional agency called Garland Compton, which was injected into a shell company, would you believe, called the Birmingham Crematorium. This was a little shell company on the London Stock Exchange, rather like Derriston, we injected S4 Capital in, or Byron Plastic Products, that was the basis of WPP. And James had the stake in the agency. And that agency was chaired by a man called Ken Gill, and he made a bid, effectively it was a reverse bid, for the Saatchi Brothers agencies, Saatchi and Saatchi. And that's how I got into the business. By accident, Maurice Saatchi was looking for a CFO. The headhunter was frustrated in his efforts to find somebody, and Maurice said, I'd like somebody like Martin. And the headhunter came, and Maurice said, that's a good idea. I'd like to have somebody like him. And the rest is history. He came, he recruited me, and I became the CFO of Saatchi's. And then my father had always said, I mean, the answer to your question is that a Jewish father probably had a great impact on me. And he said, look, find an industry that you enjoy, find a company within that industry that you enjoy, you have fun with, build a reputation. And then if you want to start a business on your own, go out and start your business. So I started WPP when I was 40 years old. Maybe a little bit on the older side. I borrowed against the stock I had in Saatchi's, and that's how I started Wireland Plastic Products. It was a shell company, and we built that into what became the world's largest advertising marketing services company.
But when you left Saatchi and Saatchi, you bought WPP, but that's a wire products company. Why didn't you buy an advertising company? Why'd you buy a wire products company?
Well, because if I was putting it crudely, one would call it the shell game, wouldn't one? And so, I mean, it's a bit like SPACs, but it's not a SPAC. It's a quoted shell company, usually a cash shell. In Wire and Plastic's case, it was a small manufacturing business. It made wire baskets. And the criteria that we had for the shell, because of our limited resources, it had to be a company with a market cap of about £1 million, no debt, a business that we could understand, a manufacturing business that we could understand, and management that was was not senile, is the way we described it, but could still run the business as we built it into a major advertising and marketing services company. But it's sort of like a SPAC. I mean, SPACs are now quite popular, not just in the US, but here in Europe, in Holland. And the Chancellor yesterday issued a report by Lord Hill. Actually, did two very interesting things, David. Firstly, S4 Capital is a dual class structure, share structure company. So I have a controlling share, and it looks like they will amend the legislation around listings to enable dual class companies to be listed as premium listings here in the UK, and even in a class called standard. We're a standard listing, which is a level under premium because we have the dual class structure. And at the moment, we're not in all the indices, but you know, if we became effectively acceptable from that point of view, we would be in the indices.
Okay. So when you started WPP, you bought that, you use it to make acquisitions, but usually people make acquisitions historically of companies that are sort of not competing with each other. You bought a number of large advertising companies, which historically competed with each other, and you put them in the same under the same roof. How did you think of that? And didn't you think people in the antitrust world would say you can't do that?
Well, it's House of Brands approach. I mean, it's interesting. If you said to me, who's the most brilliant man in terms of managing brands, I would say I know with LVMH. I mean, consistently, all the studies that we have done over the years in terms of the strength of brands, his brands, whether it be LVMH or Dior or Sephora or whatever it is, come out on top. And he runs a House of Brands approach. I can't remember how many brands he has. He might have, and he calls them Maison. I think he has about 90 odd or something. I think somebody said to me it was 93. His philosophy was you run things sort of separately, or is separately, and in a sense competitively. In the ad business, this, what I call the market share approach, which is what you just highlighted, really started in the 1950s with a man called Marion Harper, who ran Inter Public Group. And what he did was he had different agencies for different clients, primarily conflict. So if you had Procter, you had it in one agency. If you had Unilever, you had it in another agency. And at WPP, our first major deal was, which was a hostile deal, was J. Walter Thompson. And that had Unilever as a primary client. And then we added Ogilvy, which actually had Ford and Unilever, which were both JWT clients. In fact, David Ogilvy had often talked with the Thompson management two or three times about merging Ogilvy and Thompson. So it sort of fitted together. But against that, you know, later on we brought Gray in, and Gray was a big Procter agency. And that was a seminal transaction. I think we did that around 2005. And because that really did highlight the strategy, because we had Procter inside Gray and we had Unilever, you know, from a global point of view, they were sort of head-to-head competitors, but both clients accepted that. And you ran it, you know, it's a strange thing. Goldman Sachs, McKinsey could run competitive brands or competitive, could advise competitive companies, competitive brands, within the same channel, within the same brand. Agencies, for whatever reason, I don't know why really it was or why it is, agencies couldn't do that. And so having separate agencies made sense from a market share. It's a market share model.
Okay. All right.
Where you're building share.
All right. So you built WPP into the largest advertising company in the history of the world. And then you retired in 2018 from that company. And you're, let's say, 70 years old. 73. Okay. So you're 73 years old. Why didn't you say, I'm going to go just sit down and play with my grandchildren, or I'm going to do whatever you do when you're a sir. You've been knighted already. You can go to lots of places and say you're already a knight. You're knighted. Why didn't you just, you know, kind of retire? And you started a new company. Why did you do that?
Well, three reasons, really. One is my mother's genes. My mother, God bless her, died when she was 90. So, and I think I inherited her genes, physical genes. Hopefully, you know, I'll live even beyond 90. So that was one thing. Secondly, I dislike intensely the portfolio jobs. You know, I don't like dipping in and out of things. And thirdly, I think I had a point to prove. After leaving WPP, I wanted to demonstrate that we could build a very strong growth business. You know, one of the things I came under pressure with at WPP, really in 2017, was pressure on the top line. You know from your experience in private equity and beyond that like-for-like top-line growth is the key driver of total shareholder return. Now, it's different to when I was at WPP or at Saatchi's as CFO. In those days, I think there was a more equal balance between top-line growth and margin growth. Today, top-line growth, like-for-like growth, not growth through acquisitions, but like-for-like, what retailers call same-store growth, is the critically important dynamic for total shareholder return. So we're building S4 totally around digital because digital is where the growth is. Even last year, when the world was being beset by COVID, digital advertising grew. Clients switched money from traditional media, go back to one of your previous questions, into digital media. And as I look at this year, with GDP forecasts have increased by 5 to 6% by the leading investment banking houses, such as Morgan Stanley and Goldman Sachs, they were about 5 to 6 this year and 4 to 5 next year, you're going to see a very strong growth in digital advertising. It's been strong in Q4 of last year. Now, some of the numbers coming out of the platforms, Google up 21% in Q4, like for like, Amazon up 40%, Facebook up 30%. I mean, these are huge increases in digital advertising. We haven't announced our annual results for 2020 yet. We'll do that later in March. But you'll see from them the sort of growth that we're seeing in digital marketplace.
Now, what does S4 stand for? Are there four S's there or what?
Well, it's really my grandfather on my father's side came to the UK in 1899. When my mother died, I found my grandfather's marriage certificate. And he married my grandmother. He might have married, it came from Kiev as best as we can figure out in 1899, escaping the pogroms. My grandfather claimed that he cut off a Cossack's hand at the age of 10. The Cossack put his hand over the steel barrier or wall, and he claims to have taken a sword and chopped off his hand. Anyway, he came with my grandmother, and they were either remarried or married again in the UK or married for the first time, and they signed the wedding certificate with a cross, and the four witnesses signed with crosses as well, so couldn't speak a word of English. So that's S1. My father is S2. I'm S3, and my three boys are S4. I have grandkids now, 7 of them, so maybe it should be S5.
Okay, and you have 7 grandchildren.
Yeah, I do.
And you can remember their birth dates and everything?
With a little bit of prompting, yes.
Okay. So let me ask you this. Very often, advertising is designed to focus on people who are 18 to 49. What about people over 49? We buy a lot of stuff, too, and we have more money than the people under 49. Why don't you focus on people like me?
Well, they do. We do. I mean, we try and get you as well. But, you raise a very interesting question because there were a number of people who tried to build agencies around the older age groups. And the same argument as you had. I remember David Kamansky used to be on the WPP board, and he used to have these great statistics from Merrill Lynch about the wealth concentrations amongst the older age groups like you and me, or more you than me. And they would say, well, let's build. The reason that advertisers are so consumed with the younger age groups is they are the consumers of the future. So they like to build that relationship over a long period of time and for the future. I mean, many of the companies that have been successful are terrified when they look at the age profiles of their products and services because they're so geared to the older age groups and they worry about what's going to happen in the future to purchasing and penetration within the population. So it's natural to focus, to build. You remember I referred to relationships, emotional relationships. In a digital world, it tends to be a more database relationship based on data and facts. Well, but building that is the real reason why advertisers are so keen on you.
Am I watching the wrong shows when I see advertising? It's for adult diapers and dentures and things like that. Am I in the wrong television?
No. You're probably watching the right shows. Right. If it was baby diapers, probably we'd be the wrong show.
Okay. So let me ask you, if David Cameron had called you up and said, I think I'm going to lose this Brexit vote, can you get an advertising campaign that might actually save the British Empire? What would you have done?
A very difficult question. I mean, the brilliance of the Brexit campaign was take back control. And Dominic Cummings, whatever you think of Dominic Cummings, or indeed of Boris Johnson in terms of was he an opportunist or not, what they came up with was a crystal clear campaign. It was a negative campaign, but it was, you know, much easier to say no than yes, but it was to take back control. Interesting, Jeremy Hayward was the cabinet secretary to David Cameron at the time of the referendum, and his wife, sadly, Jeremy died. His wife, Suzanne Hayward, it's a book worth reading, actually, has written a book based on tapes from Jeremy before he sadly died, I think it was of cancer, a few months ago. And in that book, it describes how he tried to persuade Cameron not to go. I mean, Lionel Barber tells the story of going to the referendum was on a Thursday, and Lionel Barber went to see Cameron on the Tuesday. And what Barber had done was very interesting. He pulled many of his foreign correspondents on the Financial Times back to the UK and said, go out into the country and try and see what's going to happen on this Brexit vote. And Lionel went to see Cameron and apparently said to him, according to his report, said to him, you know, you're going to lose this. And Cameron said, no, my polls tell me we're going to win. And right up to Thursday evening, even after the polls had closed, not dissimilar to what we saw with Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump in 16, Cameron still believed he won. So I don't think Cameron thought he was going to lose, and all the data they got seemed to suggest that. But the answer to your question, you would have had to come up with a crystal clear tagline that was as effective as take back control. Take back control was, given inequality, given the fragmentation that we've seen, given the populism we've seen, was a phenomenal, you know, make America great again is another example, good or bad, of a similar, you know, campaigns and campaign slogans have to be extremely simple and crystal clear. And take back control, there's a wonderful TV documentary I'm trying to remember who produced it. I think it was on BBC, about the Cummings campaign. And it's well worth watching to see how the campaign slogan and campaign itself evolved. It was really excellent and an excellent lesson.
So you've been knighted by the Queen. I assume it was a big honor. You know, your grandfather.
My mother thought so.
All right. Your mother lived to see that. So congratulations. But suppose the Queen called you up now and said, I'd like to spiff up the royal family's image a little bit. What would you suggest the royal family do to kind of have an advertising campaign that could make them a little bit more up to date?
Well, we're on the cusp. I mean, I watch The Crown avidly, you know, and that's not necessarily a historically consistent or accurate view. But, you know, I often think about whether The Crown actually helps the monarchy and helps royalty or not. And I think net-net at the end of the day, it helps. You know, it's a bit like that great debate about when Prince Philip, which is actually referred to in The Crown series, decided to have a BBC documentary about royalty. And it made royalty seem... Some people felt it made them seem too human. I disagree. I think it's human. I think the issue, and we're on the record here, so it's tender territory, but what is happening currently, I mean, I find fascinating. I mean, this PR tug of war between Buckingham Palace and Harry and Meghan, which, you know, will come to a come to but maybe a crescendo with the Oprah Winfrey interview on March the 7th, and it will be broadcast here in the UK on ITV, I think, the following evening. I mean, it is quite extraordinary that it has got to this sort of level. I mean, we've now got accusations of bullying being laid out in the Times newspaper. So coming back to your question, I think it's an exceedingly difficult problem at the moment for the royal family. And you have Prince Philip, who has been ill. I think I read a story this morning that indicated he had heart surgery and was recovering, which I'm delighted to hear. So maybe he will make his 100th birthday and beyond. But it's an exceptionally difficult situation, David. And I don't know, I mean, this is as serious in many people's eyes as the abdication crisis with Wallace Simpson. And we'll see how it pans out. But difficult times, very difficult times.
Before we go to questions from our members, one final question. In the end, do you think, as a businessman based in Britain, that Brexit is going to be good for the business community or not good for the business community?
Well, it depends. And it depends. I mean, Rishi Sunak's budget yesterday had three elements to it. Firstly, it was to maintain protection for people who need protection, which was good. Secondly, that he signaled that he would have to balance the budget and the corporation tax to rise in 2023 from 19% to 25%. So we will still be competitive. And then thirdly, around the Lord Hill reforms, free ports, a reconstruction bank and other measures to try and improve the British economy. I mean, my view is the UK economy has to be post-Brexit. And I was a Remainer, so I didn't want to take back control from the EU. But on the basis that the die is cast, I think the next 5 to 10 years is going to be very difficult. So if the UK economy was going up on a curve like that, we've ducked down under the curve as a result of Brexit, and it's going to take, in my view, 5 to 10 years to get back on track. But the way we will do that is by being what I call Singapore on Thames or Singapore on steroids. I thought the Freeport idea, that what the government are going to do, they say they're going to do, and we have to see how much they invest in it, is create three Freeports, eight Freeports around the country. These would be lower tax zones. So, you know, the sort of things that you see in South America, for example, in the Uruguay on a smaller scale, where around Montevideo, that you've seen a burst of activity of unicorn type digital activity because tax rates are lower, infrastructure is improved, offices are built, etc. If the government can do that, if we can really, you know, there's all this stuff about digital taxes, which didn't come yesterday. There were rumors of a 2% digital tax on Amazon, etc. If the government, the Lord Hill report about dual class structures and owner-managed firms, if the government is really serious about that and puts money behind it, then you could see a faster recovery. I said 5 to 10 years, maybe it'll be faster. But we have to get in. We have to be open for business. We have to be very fleet-footed. We have to be, in a way, S4 versus, you know, a digitally focused firm versus the bigger firms in the industry versus an Accenture. And so I think there is a massive opportunity. But one other thing, I mean, Boris Johnson has not been particularly pleasant about business. He's reported to have said some unpleasant things about business and business people. Rishi Sunak, of course, is an ex-Goldman hedge fund manager, and his perspective, and he must be, interestingly, he must be a candidate for prime minister at one time, or maybe in the near future. And he's very focused on talking about advertising and PR. He's very focused on his image and the sort of things he's doing on digital media and Instagram and public relations and social media are quite sophisticated. His attitude toward business is very, very different. And you saw it in the budget statement yesterday. I think a number of the things that he came out with are really pro-business. Super deductibility on investment. You're used to that in America. We aren't in the UK. So 130% investment allowances on capital investment to try and stimulate investment. I think there's some interesting things he's doing.
Okay, let's go to questions from our members. Can you identify, give your name and identify your organization and ask a question, please? And just a simple question. Thank you. Let's have the first one.
We will take our first question from Jeffrey Rosen. Please accept the unmute now button.
Good morning or good afternoon, Martin. That was a good presentation. I'm going to risk offending David by suggesting that since this is the Council on Foreign Relations, we might ask you to comment on one issue related to foreign relations. Specifically, you were an early adopter of the importance of China and India in the future evolution of global economies. Right. Can you speak today about how you see China evolving over the next 5 years, let's say, what the issues are and the opportunities? And could you speak as well about India and how you see them relative to each other?
Okay. Just back up for a minute. WPP was a third. That's the Americas, EMEA, and Asia. We're 70-20-10, and I wanted to be 40-20-40. So that clearly signals, Jeffrey, that China and India are of critical importance. I mean, obviously, we're in most of the Asian markets, and we're in Japan and Australia and New Zealand. But, you know, it's not just about China and India. It's about Vietnam and Indonesia and the Philippines and other parts of Asia. But those are the two. Now, how do I see China? Very simple. By 2028, it will be the biggest economy in the world. It won't be on a per capita basis for a long period of time. But I've said this to David, that I'm just as worried as anybody else about the downside of globalization. The industries that have been crushed by globalization in developed markets. I'm just as concerned about inequality since Reagan and Thatcher in the 1980s. I'm just as concerned as anybody else about climate change, about Black Lives Matters and everything else. So all the other things that we are focused on in an ESG world. But the biggest issue for me at S4, I think, is the rift. Pat Paulson, must be 2 years ago in Singapore, talked about the Cold War and the rift between the US and China, which I think started under President Obama. I don't think it was just under President Trump. And of course, business people agreed with President Trump that China had taken advantage of various things, intellectual property and other things to build its economy. You now have, when one watches and listens to the first speeches from the President Biden's administration, Blinken's speech, I think yesterday or a day or so ago, China is pegged as the biggest challenge to America. And I think it's going to be very difficult for America to come to terms, or increasingly difficult to come to terms with the rise of China. So as somebody who's trying to build a global business, which means that America, and to go back to David's question about Brexit, if Brexit is going to be successful in the way that Singapore and so on, it means that we have to engage with the US, so we have to have a free trade agreement with the US and with one with China too. And is that possible? So I think the danger is we're forced to make choices, and that I'm very uncomfortable about. India, to me, is easier. I mean, you have the added complication that India, under Prime Minister Modi, has taken a very strong view on China, and the Chinese apps, for example, have been banned from China. And, you know, we've talked to a number of the Chinese companies about how they could keep their platforms and their apps operating in India, and the answer is they haven't been able to do so. So India, to my mind, will be an easier approach. For us, it's quite difficult. Our model, as you know, Jeffrey, because of your history with WPP, our model is a transparent model. The Indian and the Chinese markets, the Chinese one in particular, is not a transparent market. There is a lot of opacity there. There's a lot of corruption there. And President Xi did go after that in other areas, but in the media, it still exists. So I would say it's my number one concern. And when you talk to people about it, experts such as those in this organization that we're talking to today and others, they don't really have an answer to it. I mean, President Xi has gone, he will be in power until 2035. And the same thing applies to Putin as well, if his health holds up. So and when you talk to people, there is no solution. I mean, we hear President Biden will adopt a more multilateral approach. It will be more, probably more predictable. He'll try and secure allies to deal with China. But I don't at the moment see a way through, and I worry that we will have to make a choice. And there will be two different systems, two different approaches. And I think it could be much more difficult, Jeffrey, than, you know, WPP. At one stage, we must have had 20% of the Chinese market, 40-45% of the Indian market. I mean, to get to that again is going to be a very difficult thing to do.
We will take our next question from Tom Gloser.
Good morning, David and Martin. Good afternoon, Martin.
Good afternoon, Tom.
Could I take you back to the post-Brexit impact?
Yeah.
I think of the UK a bit as a house of brands, Scotland, England, Northern Ireland, et cetera. So what do you think the odds are we're going to see Scotland secede from the Union, followed by Northern Ireland reunifying with Ireland, and England retracts back to the Emerald Isle?
Well, England goes back to 1300, I think, technically. You might even have Plaid Cymru, which is the Welsh Nationalist Party, you know, with devolution for Wales. As you know, salmon and sturgeon are really at war with one another in Scotland, and that's just unfolded in the last 3 or 4 days. And the First Minister gave evidence yesterday for 8 hours up in Scotland. And we'll see. I don't think she'll lose the vote of confidence, but the independence movement in Scotland, I think, has been damaged by the internecine strife between the two of them. I think in both cases, Tom, I would guess that in both cases, you know, there is a strong chance of devolution in both cases. That, you know, both decisions are visceral decisions. These are, in a way, it's like David's question about the Brexit campaign. You know, I think both stir such emotions in people, and this comes back to the power of advertising and power of communication, that they stir such emotional reactions that I would, you know, if you asked me to bet money, I would have said, you know, a week, 2 weeks ago, it was even stronger, that the internecine strife within the SNP party might derail devolution. I don't think so. And then as far as North and South Ireland, I was talking to a very, very, all Irish men and women are erudite. I was talking to somebody who's in our business, and he said, well, when Northern Ireland and IRA separated 100 or so years ago, they knew that economically it was going to be debilitating, but they thought that at some point in time there would be an opportunity to bring the two parts of Ireland together. And I think that's sort of inevitable too. So I would bet, you know, it was interesting when the Chancellor yesterday talked about a United Kingdom, that he was trying to unite the country, level up the country, etc. One of the things that went through my mind is, you know, will we have a United Kingdom? Will we have a Scotland as part of it? So I think the odds are really against the UK on this, on those two issues. And Scotland maybe has got a little bit less certain, but both are visceral, and in a campaign, you know, would be difficult to combat.
We will take our next question from Andrew Gunlock. Please accept the unmute now button. Benlick, you may go ahead. If we're having some technical difficulties, we'll move on and take our next question from William Cohen.
Hi, thank you both. This is very interesting. And I wish you would both explain to us who are the artists of the paintings behind each of you, because the contrast is quite stunning. Martin, could you comment, please, on the efficacy these days of the Wunderland-Thompson merger, now some 3 years on? Is it getting the job done?
Okay, well, I think David's paintings is his mum. These are old scenes, David, from
right.
Washington.
Old scenes from Washington. My late mother-in-law painted them, yes.
They're wonderful.
And mine come from one of our people in our creative department in London at Medium Arts, which is our content practice. And it's a bit of the history of S4. So you've got Medium Arts there, you've got Mighty Hive, you've got my crest somewhere there. You've got some all sorts of funny things. You know, we called S4 a peanut at the beginning, and it became a coconut. So there's the morphing from peanut to coconut. So there's all the history there. Wunderman Thompson, that's a real specific one. When I was at WPP, still at WPP, we did talk about VML and YLR, and that was in train. And the structure was that John Cook would run, who I've got a lot of time for, and I think is exceptionally good digital executive and manager, that he would run the combined operation. Wunderman Thompson, I think, is a more difficult one. VML is a Kansas City-based digital company of considerable strength and a pure digital company. Wunderman is more mixed. In a way, it's a little bit like Ogilvy One, in that its origins, Lester Wunderman, etc., were in direct mail and direct marketing. So some of its operations are not quite as strong in the digital area as you would believe. So quite more mixed. JWT had gone through some leadership changes, unforced and some forced, and I think was not in a particularly strong condition to merge. The other thing is, I think when you put two businesses together, even if they're in the same parent company, if you call them, for example, Wunderman Thompson, it clearly signals that digital or perceived digital is more important than traditional. It also is a bit of a breaker for a break for the management of the traditional agency. You call it Wunderman Thompson, it clearly relegates Thompson to secondary status. And if then the management of the company are all Wunderman people, the Thompson people, their heads go down and their shoulders slump. So I think if I had been there, I don't think we would call it VML Y&R, we would call it Y&R VML. That may sound sort of pedantic, but I do think what it would say is John Cook's in charge of it from VML, but there's equal voices for the more traditional part of the business and the new part of the business. And the same would be true of Wunderman Thompson. I'd call it Thompson Wunderman. I don't think when you fuse these businesses in the way that it's done, that you immediately create a digitally led or digitally strong company by just slamming two things together. I think it has to be done more carefully, probably over a longer period of time, and maybe at a different time when each of the individual constituent parts are a little bit stronger. So net-net, I don't think it's been, if one looks at the marketplace, I don't think Wunderman Thompson has made the inroads. There's a lot of movement of money revenues within the company. So even VML YMR, for example, I'm aware that large amounts of the Ford business, getting very specific, were switched from GTB, which is a specialist Ford agency, into VML. So when you look at the relative performance that's claimed, it's quite difficult. The other thing I would say is this, when you look at WPP as a whole, when you think about what we did with JWT and Ogilvy, for example, we took the media operations out and the digital operations out and put them into other parts of WPP. So it's very unfair. You know, it's a bit like you had a body and you chop the arms off and you chop the legs off and you say you haven't got a healthy human being. Well, you haven't, because you've taken the growth parts and put them into other different parts of the operation. So I think when you look at a company like WPP, you can't segment one channel or one brand from the other. You have to look at what's happening to the thing as a whole. And you can't point to one part of it. It's a bit like squeezing a balloon and saying, this is doing better than the other, because you have to look at the whole thing. And one of the interesting things about S4 is that we have four principles. One is purely digital. Number two is this data-driven model that I described. Number three, you go to market as faster, better, cheaper. And the fourth is we have a unitary structure. And we have no cross-charging with inside the company. It's one P&L, and we look at the whole organization as one and not the individual parts. And I think that's really important in this day and age, because that's what clients want.
Our next question, we'll go back to Andrew Goodluck.
Can you hear me this time?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry about that. hi, Martin and David. Martin, I'd like your view on the advertising business broadly, in the sense that for the first time ever, I believe, media companies are going direct to consumer. Netflix, of course, leading the way. Some views is it's all going to be subscription, cord cutting, et cetera. Outside the U.S., of course, a different story. But you're starting to see the AVOD models, and the CPMs, of course, are much higher in this direct world, because to pick up on David's earlier point, you can target David with the right kind of diapers, not the wrong ones. But the question is, how do you see Nielsen, company David knows well, and that rating? How are you, are the CPMs sustainable at these higher levels? Will Netflix have advertising one day? How do you see the big picture? And will advertising budgets ultimately be higher or lower 5 and 10 years from now?
Well, a lot of questions there. So we clearly see digital as being where the growth is. I mean, we've taken a risk with S4 in the sense, I had a case of it this week where the business was up for review and, the client said to me, you don't have traditional coverage. I'm not interested in the traditional part of the business, because that's a zero-sum game. As the traditional agencies fight for talent amongst one another and poach one another's talent, as they fight for accounts and compete, with procurement at the client to lower prices or give inflation guarantees or pricing guarantees, it just doesn't make any sense to me. Digital is more about brain than brawn, and the traditional advertising business is more about volume. The new business, the digital business, is around brain and adaptability. If you're buying online digital media in a nanosecond, you need brain power, not brawn. So digital will grow this year by 20%. It's 50% of the media market, that 500 to 550 billion I mentioned as part of the 1.7 trillion. And it will be 70% of the market by 2024. That's where the growth is coming. The ad revenues will be a mixture of subscription and advertising. I mean, if you take the 275, 280 billion of digital advertising last year, Google's around 170, 180, Facebook's about 80, and Amazon's about 20. And Snap, which has done extremely well, only generated, 2.5 billion of revenue. So when you look at the orders of magnitude, the only platform of the six, the other three being, in addition to Google, Facebook, and Amazon, Alibaba, Tencent, and TikTok. TikTok's the only one that really has generated significant volumes. It's about, in 2019, it's a KKR investment. 2019, I think it was about $7 billion. That's the only one that's really got the Twitter, Pinterest is even less than Snap, and Snap is doing well. So you have to look at where the money's going. So on the advertising side, and we saw Google make this big move yesterday around third-party cookies or crumbling third-party cookies. and Apple had gone the same way with IDFA. So first-party data relationships with consumers. So our relationship with David, in terms of, with his consent, to understand his media habits, purchasing habits, etc., and to serve him with content that's meaningful, we'll use first-party data to do it, and we use the signals from the walled gardens, of which Google is one, Facebook's another, Apple's another, Microsoft's another, etc. We'll be using this with increasing frequency. So that's the way the business is going to go. On Netflix, my own view is, and I think Reed Hastings would disagree violently, that they will take advertising. They'll offer a Spotify-type premium service where you don't have advertising, and a discounted service where you do. And I think that's the way to go. Disney Plus is making huge inroads. It must be the most successful new product launch ever. And I can't remember, you know, it's 90 million now? And they say they'll go to 240 million by 2024, I think it is. So it's a super successful launch. And look what's happened to Disney. I mean, with all the COVID threatened parks, theme parks, cruises, it still has prospered through the Fox merger. And it turns out that Rupert Murdoch made a stunningly successful decision to merge Fox in parts of Fox into Disney. So I think those are some of the things. Disney came in at a lower price point to Netflix at the beginning. It's upped its prices. Maybe that's relieved a little bit of the pressure on Netflix. But you know, some people I talk to think that Netflix will end up inside Apple. We'll see whether that happens at any particular point in time, because Apple really is starting to focus on services and content is part of that. So we'll see how that develops further.
We'll take our last question from Joseph Bauer. Please accept the unmute now button. Bauer, you may go ahead. I believe we're having some technical difficulties, and he was the last question. So, Mr. Rubenstein, over to you.
Okay. All right. Well, Martin, I want to thank you very much for giving us this much of your time and insights. And I want to remind everybody that this video will be on the CFR website right after this. And thank you very much, Martin, and good luck when you get your second shot, you'll be won't have an adverse reaction to it. You'll be in good shape.
Thank you very much, David, for doing this. Much appreciated. Anybody wants to, if Joe is out there and finds the mute button or whatever it is, it's martin@s4capital.com, or anybody else, happy to consider to continue the conversation. And a big thank you, David, for doing this. Much appreciated.
Thanks very much.